You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without research. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God, who tests our hearts. You know we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We are not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else. Even though as apostles of Christ, we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you, just as a nursing mother cares for her children. So we care for you, because we love you so much. We were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preached the gospel of God to you. You are witnesses, and so is God, of how holy, righteous, and blameless we were among you who believed. For you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, who calls you into his kingdom and glory. And we also thank God continually, because when you received the word of God, which you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human word, but as it actually is, the word of God, which is indeed at work in you who believe. For you, brothers and sisters, became imitators of God's churches in Judea, which are in Christ Jesus.
Love God.
Love your neighbor.
In chapter 1, we learn that the gospel works in a loving community, the church. So in chapters 2 and 3, we learn how Paul preached the gospel and lived among the Thessalonians. He had a great shepherd heart, like a parents, nursing mothers, and father toward the Thessalonians. At the same time, the Thessalonians accepted Paul's preaching not as a human word, but as God's word. As a result, almost an ideal church was established in Thessalonica. This is the church that Paul wrote to without any criticism. It was an amazing ministry. The gospel itself has a power. But the effectiveness of the gospel is closely related to the lives of gospel workers and the response of the hearers. Many people have asked Dr. Billy Graham the secret of his fruitful ministry. His response is simple. Keep your preaching focused on the gospel message and live with integrity. On the other hand, if a gospel worker loses integrity, the gospel message will be discredited. In today's passage, the enemies of the gospel accused Paul of having an impure motive, namely to make money. They planted doubt in the hearts of the Thessalonian believers to discredit the gospel message. In dealing with them, Paul revealed his integrity as a gospel worker. Gospel workers must live with integrity to advance the gospel. At the same time, those who hear the gospel must accept it, not as a human word, but as a God's inspired word. These two conditions must be met in order that the gospel works powerfully. So in Paul's day, there were a group of people known as traveling philosophers. They would go from city to city and speak in public areas, and then leave. They became the brunt of jokes, because although they spoke well and seemed to impress people initially, What they did had very little impact on helping people. In fact, they tried to make money from people and gain their own fame and glory. They were manipulative of the crowds they spoke to. They used the deceptive speech, flattery, and were trying to get people to give money to them. So as we have seen, Paul's experience in Thessalonica was very brief. He was there for only 3 weeks. He had to leave in a hurry and did not go back in person. So his enemies were evidently spreading rumors that Paul was just like one of those traveling philosophers. So in this part of his letter, he reminds the Thessalonians of their first-hand experience with him. He repeatedly said, you know, or you remember. A key element in growing Christian faith is to have a personal experience of the gospel. It cannot be based on what other people are telling us. And this personal experience, in light of this letter, often comes through personal experience with a genuine servant of Christ. So look at verse 1. You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit to you was not without results. The results Paul mentions here are similar to what he said in chapter 1, because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but with power, with the Holy Spirit, and deep conviction. This is what happened in the people who heard the apostles' teaching. In a word, they were changed. This is actually the first test of whether anyone is really serving Christ. Are there such results? Are people changed through their ministry? So examine yourself, examine your life. Are people are changed through your gospel preaching? Or is your Bible study or fellowship are simply human fellowship? Because if there is no change, then we have to examine the way we interact or teach the Bible. Look at verse 2. We had previously suffered and been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. The Thessalonians knew how the apostles had been treated outrageously in nearby Philippi. So remember, I told you last week, Paul and Silas were stripped naked, beaten with rods, and severely flogged and put in jail, even though they didn't do anything wrong. They simply helped one slave girl who was demon-possessed. And the owners realized that they could not make money through this slave girl. They put them in prison. So when they arrived in Thessalonica, surely they were still recovering from all the wounds on their bodies. And believers there could actually see how beaten up they had been. Then they experienced strong opposition in Thessalonica as well, when some jealous Jews started a riot and almost killed the apostles. So Paul writes, with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel. He did not say, well, we learned our lesson in Philippi. Because of what happened there, we decided not to be so bold, since we offended so many people and got into so much trouble, we decided to redesign our ministry and make it a little less offensive. I mean, that's what, you know, many people do. I would do it, you know, with so much opposition. But Paul is different. So apostles' courage and persistence were the further proof that they were real servants of Christ. Amen. Then Paul goes on to describe their motives. Look at verses 3 through 6a. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. You know, we never used flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We are not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else. So if someone flatters you, watch out. Some people try to teach others when they themselves are in error, and some have impure motives. So what are the impure motives? They try to use people for their own gain and gratification. And they're not really interested in helping or building them up. A pure motive means, above all else, just trying to please God. People may not be able to see our motives, but God can. God is our witness. God is watching us. God tests our hearts. God wants us to share the gospel simply in order to please Him, simply because we love people. So if we try to please people, we would always preach the prosperity gospel, saying, God will make you successful, healthy, and wealthy. And no prosperity gospel would say, endure hardship. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. Or nor do they talk about the judgment on sinners who do not repent. But we should tell the judgment, not just love. Don't say just God loves you on sinners who do not repent. We have to teach the message of judgment in order to please God, because that's the message they need to hear. Paul also mentioned in these verses how some people are good at hiding their real motives. They put on a mask, meaning they act like they care when they don't. They speak flattering words, but what they want is people's praise or financial support. We are all sinners who, given the situation, would act the same way. We need God's help to be genuine and have a pure motives. In verse 4, Paul says, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. Do you see this amazing statement? Who can say that? It's not a self-promotion. It is a sobering truth. God approves of certain people and entrusts them with His precious gospel. Having God's approval and God's trust is the best there is. Huh? What a wonderful privilege it is to be entrusted with His gospel. So in the last part of verse 6, Paul writes, even though as apostles of Christ, we could have asserted our authority, those who are chosen by God to be Christ's apostles have a Christ authority. But Paul did not use his authority to dominate others or command them. So because our Lord Jesus told us, remember in Mark chapter 10, you know those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles, lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them, but not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. And Paul and the other apostles obeyed this teaching of Jesus in practically in their lives, in dealing with the people. That's why Paul did not lord it over others. Look at verses 7 and 8. Instead, we are like a young children among you, just as a nursing mother cares for children, so we cared for you. So when Paul says, we are like young children among you, he meant not only that they didn't exercise authority, but also that they were humble, honest, vulnerable, not manipulative. The Thessalonians did not have much time with the apostles, but they could immediately tell how authentic they were. The same is true today. In ministry, we don't have to put on an act. We just have to be ourselves, be authentic. Then Paul says that the apostles live like a nursing mothers, caring for children, nursing mothers. Nursing mother, do you know what nursing mother is? Breastfeeding, yeah. So she has to get up at 3 a.m. to feed her children. Like, for example, Joshua was young. She was a big boy. She would get up at 3 a.m., well, multiple times. And my wife just had a C-section. Oh. And sore, very sore. But you have to get up to feed, right? Because she's crying. And she would push me and help me. But you have to do that. Otherwise, the baby will starve. So nursing mother is not thinking of herself. She is thinking of her children. She's basically very unselfish. She's not getting paid to do it. Look at verse 8, AB. Because we love you so much, we are delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well. Mm-hmm. A nursing mother loves her own children. So she's ready to wake up at 3 a.m. or stop whatever else she's doing to tend to them. Mm-hmm. You have to stop immediately your Instagram or Facebook. Nursing mother is not thinking about how much money she'll get or how they will someday repay her. She's doing it purely out of genuine love. Many people are willing to preach or teach, but not many are willing to live like a nursing mothers for infants. Actually, some may ask even why that is necessary. Why do you have to do that? Why have to go such a great length? But new believers are in many ways like a newborns. They are weak and vulnerable and in need of nurture and protection. No one would just spend an hour a week with a newborn and expect him to survive well for the rest of the week. You cannot expect that. So likewise, if you are going to be a real help to those who are young and new in faith, it requires much sacrifice, spending quality time together. And the only way to get there, genuinely, is when God fills us with his love. So remember, do you see the share our lives? Share our lives in Greek is literally share our souls. It means to share our very selves. Paul and apostles opened their hearts to these new believers. They made themselves vulnerable. Just like he said, we are like young children. Thus, you remember C.S. Lewis quotes, to love is to be vulnerable. No traveling philosopher would ever do that. So how can you live like the apostles? So in our sinful nature, we are too selfish. We need the help of the Holy Spirit. God pours out his great love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Through the Holy Spirit, we are united with Christ and receive encouragement, comfort, tenderness, and compassion. Through the Holy Spirit work in us, God transforms us into a humble, self-sacrificing, nurturing, and mindful servants who genuinely cares for others' spiritual growth. So through the Holy Spirit, even a macho man can be like a nursing mothers for their little children. Surely you remember, brothers and sisters, our toil and hardship. We work night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone while we preach the gospel of God to you. Here Paul mentions their self-supporting ministry. While living among these new believers, the apostles never asked for financial support. In fact, as an apostle of Christ, Paul was entitled to material support, but they forego their support. Mm-hmm. They worked night and day in order not to be a burden to anyone. They spent quality time with ministering to these new believers, but in their spare moment, they also worked to earn money to support themselves. So Paul was a tent maker by trade. So he probably worked while others were sleeping in order to make an income. And Silas and Timothy must have worked at some occupation too. They paid for their own meals and rent. So they did it in order to make it clear that they were there not to get anything, but to give. So it seems to have been especially important when ministry was just beginning, so that these new believers may not get the wrong idea about Paul and Silas and Timothy. Mm-hmm. Look at verses 11 and 12. For you know that we dealt each of you as a father deals with your own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God, mm-hmm. who calls you into his kingdom and glory. Here Paul changes the metaphor from nursing mothers to fathering. Mothers nurture, but father's discipline. But this is not harsh discipline. It is encouraging, comforting, and urging. So children need both mother and father. I mean, some people think that children need only mother. That's not correct. They need the father's presence. But the fathering in many places has become a lost art. So many are not prepared to father others. Something that is just use of fatherly authority. Just use, command them or use harsh words. But here Paul describes fathering as encouraging, comforting, and urging. Many fathers love their children, but they don't know how to do that spiritually. They just spoil them. Spiritual fathering is to help people to live lives worthy of God and of being called His kingdom and glory. Look at verse 13. Here Paul shifts the focus from the apostle ministry to the Thessalonians' acceptance. The secret of spiritual growth is accepting the word of God as it is. So God's servants should give the word with the right motives, but people who need to accept it as the word of God, how easy it is to look at God's servants humbly. How easy it is to interpret what is being taught humanly. But the word of God is not like a human words. Human words may seem impressive, but in the end they are forgettable. But the word of God is powerful because it is inspired by God himself. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16 says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So the word of God continues to work in us long after we hear it. More than anything else, we need to be listening carefully to the word of God. And we need the confidence to give people the word of God as it actually is. So in conclusion, the gospel worked powerfully in Thessalonica because of two factors. The gospel worker, Paul, preached the gospel with a great shepherd heart. And the Thessalonians received Paul's message as the word of God. And these two combinations bring great work of God in any region, in any culture, in any age group. Paul's life and ministry is a blueprint for the gospel workers to follow. So may the gospel of Jesus Christ work in this campus powerfully as we follow Paul's example.